here we are. I watched my work. Okay, so we're going to start out with Watch My Work. And some people are here for Watch My Work. I just don't want to be like, how are you? I forgot your name. But Brian, but I know your thing, so I can't forget that. You're sitting good.
Yeah.
Not like floating.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we go way back, like till last year. Okay, so we're here. Anybody not know what Watch Me Work is? First time here? Okay, so I'll explain it really, really fast. So like 6 years ago, no, I'm kidding. 6 years ago, we've been doing this for 6 years, so we're like really, really good at it, right? Because Carol's been like every single Watch Me Work since 2009 and 2010, right. Okay, so this is basically what we do. This was 6 years ago, 7 years ago, this was my answer to somebody who wanted me to write a play for their festival. And I was like,
lazy.
So I was like, no, I ain't writing nothing. But I'm gonna stand on stage and write something on stage. And then, so we're gonna write for 20 minutes. We're gonna do it together. We're gonna do the action of the play. It's a play, as you can see. See, this means it's a play. Really, that's what it means. So we're gonna make a play together. So the action of the play is that we do the action for 20 minutes together. We're gonna write for 20 minutes together. Okay, you can do whatever. Watch Me Work is actually about you. Got that. And then we're gonna do the dialogue of the play together, which means after the 20 minutes, the timer will go off, and you will ask me questions about your creative process. Got it? You ask me questions about your creative process, and everybody knows who's been here before that if you ask me questions about my creative process, I'm gonna make it about you. Okay? So it's gonna be questions about your work and your creative process. There are people online, we know you're out there, and maybe you're gonna tweet in and ask us some questions about your creative process, and you're just gonna tell us how to do that.
Hello, so if you're joining us from home, the Twitter handle that you want to tweet us is at WatchMeWorkSLP, and the hashtag is hashtag HowlRound. So that's hashtag HowlRound.
HowlRound.
Exactly. Right.
Okay, so that's all, everything that you need to know, or beauty is truth and truth is beauty. That's all you need to know, or something like that. That's James Keith's added makeup. And what else? Anybody else? Anything else? No, you have something, someone's texting you? You got the timer, you're gonna time with me? All right, so Salma's gonna be on her phone timer, and I'm gonna use this. And I have to decide what I'm gonna work on. Okay, I just made a decision.
Okay, great.
All right, I'm gonna use a typewriter, for those of you who have never seen one. Don't worry, it's not the sound of a machine gun.
Ready? You gotta turn around. Don't look at me.
Okay, yes, that's right.
Yeah, right. Tybalt? I'm gonna call you Tybalt.
So that was the action part of the play. And now we're going to do the dialogue. So if anybody has questions as I try to put back together my typewriter. It's, you know, typewriters are funny. You have to like make the ribbon go and all this kind of stuff, you know. So if anybody has questions about your work, your creative process, now is the time. Yes. Oh yeah, okay.
I have a hard time. Okay, so Adiaga.
Uh-huh. Oh, what a pretty name.
Thank you. I'm having a hard time. I'm frustrated with myself in this whole process because I'll have these wonderful characters,
right?
And I'll have these moments of these moments
right.
between characters,
right.
But I have no idea where the hell this is going. I asked my friend, do you have like an end point before you start?
Right.
And then you just, and so people have been telling me, just write, just keep writing. And that's frustrating to me.
Right.
I need to know where I'm going.
Right.
So the question for you is, do you have an end point? Like, do you already have the plot
right.
in your mind as to
right.
what it's going to end up being?
Right.
And then you write towards that?
So, right. So we use Adiaga says, hey, did you guys hear? She's like, right. So her friend just says her friend. You can tell what I'm going to say. And I'm like judging on your poor, wonderful friend who gave you some beautiful advice. And that is advice that is often given. People say, oh, just write, don't worry about it. That is good advice, actually, because this is a two-part answer, sorry. So the good advice is just write, get into it, show up every day, put in the time. You're going to be saying that a lot, right? So you're going to show up every day, you're going to put in the time. You're not going to just write when, like, inspiration comes. You should be waiting.
Right.
Okay. So you show up and the muse will go, oh, yeah, she's serious, I'm going to come by her house. Okay? So you show up every day. You do that already. But then, see, this is what I've heard. People go, just write. And people go, the story, it will just happen. I know, Samantha's like, it's not gonna happen. I mean, it might just happen. You might just walk outside and a piano will be falling from the sky. And you just happen to see it in time and happen to move out of the way and then happen to fall right beside you. And then the box. You know, whatever it's called, the Goldberg variations happen to begin to be playing on it. Yeah, it could happen, sure. Or you could sort of think about it a little bit, right? And allow it to emerge. And this is the thing. People, and I've heard people say this, wonderful people who are wonderful writers, they go, I love my characters, but then I have to, like, figure out some plot. Like that. And that's, no, right. So this is what you do. You show up every day. You're doing that already? Okay, check. Okay. You're writing like, hello characters, blah, 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 check. Okay, now, you ask your characters a question. It's like dating. Like, you show up on the first date, you'd like coffee. I mean, this is what I suggest, not alcohol. You do coffee. Hey, how you doing? What's your name? What's your sign? How you doing? You like my profile? Yeah, okay, cool, right. And then I come into the third date. You go, so what are your intentions? It's the same thing with playwriting, right? It's the same thing. So what do you want out of this relationship? What do you want out of this relationship? You ask the character, what do you want? What do you want? Right? Because if you say, hey, let's just get in the car and drive around, after three dates of doing that, I'm like, hey, girl, where are we going? And you're like, we're going to California. And I'm like, I'm out of here. I got stuff to do. Or I'm like, yeah, I'm in it. Let's go on a road trip. So ask your characters, what do they want? What do you want more than anything? And as we said, I don't know, I just made this up, but I think it worked. In geometry, there's this geometric, there's like a rule or something. A truth, or whatever they call it in geometry. Two points make a line. What's it called? Is it proof or a formula, something like that. Yeah. 2 points make a line, right? That's true in geometry. So you can say that the same as in like dramatic writing. 2 points make a line. So here they are, like in Three Sisters. You know, play Three Sisters? Check off. So here they are, and they want to go to Moscow. Point A, point B. And you just fill in the middle stuff. See?
That sounds really simple.
Yeah, you just ask them what they want. What do you want? But you don't have to do that right away. Again, you develop a kind of rapport with them, like on dating. You don't ask someone, what are your intentions on the first date? You know what I mean? Because they're like, oh.
Right.
Take some time with them. Get to know them. Okay, is that all right? So it's a combination of things. And the plot emerges organically from the character. Plot and character are actually two ways of saying the same thing. Plot is character, character is plot. They're actually the same thing. We get confused when we think they're two different things. That's what I think. But again, I didn't go to grad school, so I'm just making shit up. Oh, so then you just...
No, I'm good.
You
know?
Okay.
But right now...
What?
I'm hoping the play will like pivot into something that makes sense, but right now it's just a mess.
Yeah.
It's sort of, I can sort of see something is happening.
Is this the fireman guy who was passed away in real life?
Yeah,
okay.
I ran around Lower Manhattan doing a 5K two Sundays ago.
You ran?
I ran around
really?
The site.
Was someone chasing you?
They
no, you were just running for like...
No, it was a 5K.
For help. Oh, good, great, okay.
So, but I remember I ran around and there were all these like incredibly old historic places, and it's sort of 9/11 has layered on top of that.
Right.
And I'm just like, how do I'm getting caught up in like, how do I honor that? I want to make sure that, you know, when I go, that I have something to leave behind. So I'm feeling like I'm putting a lot of silly pressure on myself.
God.
I'm like, yeah. I really don't want this responsibility.
How do I make sure that when I pass away, I'll leave something? Yeah. That's a lot.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm like, it was on fire, and that's what was going on after the Twin Towers fell.
Right.
It was on fire, and then I got to, you know, cursed or privileged with being there and seeing that firsthand.
Right.
And I'm just like, I think what I'm doing, I'm trying to make it palatable, and
right.
I think it's turning into this, like, I'm making it a bigger issue than it is, and I'm trying to sit and do it, and there's just so many layers of everything that I'm just.
Well, or maybe you're responding appropriately to the ginormous issue that it is. Yes.
Yeah.
But you can separate your response from what you're going to do as a writer.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
You are a first responder, are you not?
Yeah. I was there.
So great. So you got a first responder in you.
Yeah.
Your response, and then you can have like a second responder who is your writer, okay? So just think that you have two people inside you, okay? The first responder and this person. And this person is just both eyes on the story, hear the voice of your friend that you said is the main character of the story, ask him what he wants, send him on that journey, be with him. Listen to him. Write down what he says. When you get in that first responder, oh my God, it's huge. Go back to your friend. Make sure when you feel those feelings, know that number one, they're appropriate. And number two, you have a different job now. That job is over. It's the second responder job now. Right? Okay? Okay, so because I don't think it's going to help you to tell yourself that you're, not, you know, oh man, I'm just making too much of this. Right? You're making the appropriate much of it. But you got another job to do now. Okay?
To younger kids who were just old enough to know something happened and saw old pictures, now they're looking at new pictures, and
okay.
It's kind of an interesting place to be an age where I'm explaining, like, there was New York then, and there's New York now, and
right.
What happened.
Right, right.
So,
right.
I'm walking a kind of an interesting tightrope.
Well, does your character have to explain the skyline?
I should ask him.
tie it to your character, because that's your job now.
Yeah.
You're a writer, so and your characters are your fuel, right? They're the ones that you have to stay connected to. Otherwise, you're kind of doing this, like, you might as well write an op-ed piece or something.
Yeah, I don't
you know what I'm saying? Right, and that's not what you do. So, stay with your characters. Does he need to explain the skyline?
I think so.
Okay, then have it come out of his need to explain something to somebody. Just again, stay with your characters. If you feel overwhelmed or all those things, go back to your characters. Okay?
Yeah.
That's a big question. Well, keep coming back because it's like so great to hear you talk about it.
I noticed an interesting problem that I didn't realize that I have until. I'll write stories and characters and all that kind of thing. And I'll realize, like adult characters, and I'll realize that they don't have jobs. Like not jobs within the plot, I mean like career jobs.
They don't have career jobs.
Yeah, and obviously they need to because they're living in their own house and supporting themselves and all that kind of thing. Like they need jobs, but it just kind of only occurs, unless it's a story
unless
driven
they're
by.
They're on Friends or something.
Yeah. And unless it's a story driven by their job, like, so I was wondering, like, if, you know, like, what's a good way of coming up with a job, an occupation for a character?
Well, I don't know, that's a good question. I'm glad that you think they should have jobs, because they're living in their homes, and you want to create your stories, your dramas, your things that you're writing, want to be kind of grounded in some kind of, throw a job at them, see if they like it. You know what I mean? And ask them also, what does your character want out of his or her job? One woman might say, yeah, well, I just got to pay the rent. And my rent is, you know, so you say, well, why don't you work at Starbucks or whatever? She's like, that's not going to pay my rent. Why don't you work at Starbucks and at Think Cafe? She's like, that's not going to pay my rent. Okay, maybe you want to be a pole dancer. Now you're talking about paying the rent. You see what I mean? So she just wants to pay her rent. Someone else might want some kind of, you know, do good for the people. Great, you want to do good for the people? Yeah, I'm going to be a teach second grade. Great, okay. So what do you need, you know, ask them what they want. Again, what they want, what they need, the same thing.
So it's like as a part of the character, like use the job to develop the character.
Well, yeah, otherwise, again, you're having an outer body experience where you shit just don't got nothing to do with shit.
Well, it's just hard sometimes because, like, sometimes the story doesn't, like, their job isn't necessarily relevant. It just feels like they should have a job just as, like, a detail.
Let's see if we can think of I can't think of Shakespeare. Nobody had jobs in Shakespeare.
They were princes.
Yeah, princes were both, like, they were, like, members of the court. No. Snug, the joiner. I don't remember any of the other ones. Snug the joiner. Right, they had a lot of jobs, right? And they took time off from work to put on this play. There's also a mason. You know, they had all kinds of jobs. Okay, you could say they're not relevant to. What did Bottom do? Did he do
anything? He's a
carpenter.
He's a carpenter?
Okay. You know, Mercutio. I'm going to call you Mercutio now. Not Tybalt. I know, you're Mercutio. Mercutio knows. Okay, so you're right. You could say they're irrelevant, or you could say how interesting because here are these mechanicals doing this play, and they're trying to do this, Thisbe, Thisbe. What do they do in Paris and Thisbe? And they were so bad. You know? So you could say it has something to do because they're rude mechanicals, right? Why don't you say, like, it'll have something to do with the story. And it might lead you somewhere that your conscious mind is at.
Very true.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That was very good. All right.
The jobs they do.
The jobs they do.
It seems to like inform the character.
Yeah. In Midsummer Night's Dream.
Yeah.
Okay. See?
Because in the play, like, you hear opinions
right.
of each one.
Right.
Like, and then I always envision him like, as like an older fella,
right.
the man who hangs the moon.
Right.
He has to correct the guy, and just like how practical they are
right.
in their nature,
right.
and the language seems to.
So it might, it probably does inform the way they speak and what they're concerned with. Oh, that's good.
So yeah. Okay, you've got your work cut out for you. All right. Your name's not really. I mean,
Jorge.
Jorge. Okay, but I can call you Mercutio.
You can.
Okay. And this
I am Mercurial in other ways. So yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna stand over here.
No, right. not threatening. Not threatening.
Okay, I know you're right. Okay. Anybody else? Maybe we'll just sit here and enjoy each other's company. I'm just looking at you. Yes, Carol.
I started out today with nothing.
You know, nothing.
Nothing.
Something.
Yeah, well, so I started out with no muse today. Don't know what to say. That's when I knew I was in trouble. I got paper and pen, but no words, no zen. What will I write about today? Sometimes you just start writing about
nothing.
Right. How do I feel? I gotta get real. That'll be useful to me. I'll sit down right now, think of a character who wake up my imagination. Who will it be? It's so appropriate what she's talking about, which I didn't know. Is he or she? That's the fascination. Someone I like or I don't. I'll definitely be here to find out. Ready to listen to all he's about. Ready to hear if she'll whisper or shout. It's like taking dictation from a ghost. I pick out the lines I like the most. Then I shop and I stare. I figure out where the scene is and when. A village or a farm, a room or a barn, long ago or today. The story will find the way to the page. I'll engage another character to join in. That's my imagination at play. I'll toss out a problem their way. I'll listen while they work it out. I totally hear what they're saying. And that's all I got. But it's just not what you're talking about.
We're just showing up.
Showed up.
You know, you got a lot. Carol's written a lot of books. So you know, but you know that. You
just
know.
Have days
right. You have days when you have. You do have days when you're in there. And what do you do this? You do this at home in your own practice.
Yes.
Just show up.
Just show up.
Yeah.
See what you got today.
And the cool thing is like, it doesn't matter. The quality of it doesn't matter. The fact that you just show up and do your work is the thing that matters. So we're not, you know, what you read is really cool and fun to listen to, but say, you know, I wrote something, I don't know if it's cool or interesting to listen to, it doesn't matter. The quality of it doesn't matter. The fact that you show up and put the time in is the thing that matters. And eventually, over time, you'll have time to improve on the quality. But if you're sitting around waiting for the quality to be great before you sit down, you're gonna be waiting. You know, the world will be turning.
It's like you have to like get out of your own way, and that kind of keeps you stuck because you're. I'm sorry.
No, you're supposed to be talking now.
No, it's like, you know, for me when I first started, it was like I felt like I was in my own way, and the questions I would say to myself that would be a barrier for me is, would this be interesting for someone else? Will someone else care what the hell I'm writing about?
Right.
Will it matter to somebody?
Right.
And I think for me, I had to like get over that hurdle.
Right.
That it's my story.
Right.
It's gonna matter to somebody.
Right.
It might not be relevant to everyone.
Right.
But there will be an audience for
right.
it that cares about what the hell you're writing about.
Right.
So I think once I just accepted that, then that
right.
got me ready to start writing.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what they say? That's a really good point. You know what they say when people are trying to, you know, want you to feel good about yourself? They say, you are enough.
Right.
You can say the same thing about your work. You're enough. You are enough. You are enough audience. You're enough.
Right.
And if you care, that's enough. That's enough to get it written right there. If you care, if I care about my own work, that's enough. I don't sit around going, oh, I hope somebody cares about this. I care. And if I care, that's enough.
Right.
You know, and that's enough to get you sitting down and put the time in.
Yeah. It doesn't matter if it upsets someone else.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's another question.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, China. No, China. Something. Gina. Yeah? Oh, see, I'll think of a chia pet now. All right. Yeah.
Childhood memories. I'm having a
challenge with one character, and I want to know, is there like a bullet point for creating waves? Like in terms of like, you know, when you're... Okay, so my inspiration for the One Woman Show was Back to Broadway, and a lot of Whoopi's characters were like, there was always like the high and the low and the high and the low with this character. And my character, we get high sometimes and that is funky. I mean, it's cool because I did,
right?
But it's not, I don't feel like I'm sharing, I feel like I'm having a personal moment. So I'm stuck with like high, low, high, low. Does that make sense? Like adding some extra seasoning where everyone kind of gets the feel of what I'm trying to express in this character.
Yeah, how much of it do you have written?
It's a little all over the place. Like, I have, if I accumulate all, I probably say like 50 pages.
Okay.
But it's not insane. It's like, I have a lot of relationships with different, so I don't write it as a play. I'm still kind of like, okay, today I'm going to spend a day with this character. And today I'm going to spend a day with that character. So I haven't really put them all together.
So put them together and see. The wave. I mean, the wave, I mean, you're talking, Gina's talking about a one-woman show, right? And you want to get this comedic moments and more introspective, serious moments. Is that what you're talking about? The wave. Okay, I like that. Okay. What you want to do, you got to put it all together to see if it's going to move like that. Because that's, I remember her characters were a funny moment, a sad moment, a funny moment, a sad moment. And the juxtaposition is what really, yeah, I would say, get to the end and take a look at it. I know, everybody, people are like, oh, I gotta get to the end. Oh, you're gonna go home.
I was just
looking. Can you see?
I caught it.
Oh, yeah, because people are like, oh, I don't wanna get to the end. I don't wanna get to the end. When I just said get to the end, you're like, you gave me the.
But I feel like I haven't deserved the end yet. Like that last bite of that good dish. I haven't really savored the rest of the dish yet.
No. The last bite of the good dish, my friend, is the standing ovation and the cheers when they say, oh, wow, I sweat, you awesome. That's the last bite of the good dish. This is just, girl, you're still working on it.
Right.
You do deserve to let yourself write to the end.
Okay.
You deserve to do the work.
Okay.
That's not that's a treat, but it's not like,
I feel you.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So go to the end and see what you got. Then you got the whole thing and you'll be able to, I can tell your face is going. And so I know that you're not anticipating the last bite of the delicious dish.
But it's not the dish. So I'm going to reprogram my brain and say, this is not the dish. You're still cooking the meal.
Enjoy
so
the
you
cooking.
You got to finish it.
Enjoy the cooking. Yeah.
Yeah. And trust that what I'm baking is going to be, and I might have to cook it again.
Sure.
But at least I finished it. I get it. I'm with you now. I see it in a different way. I'm okay.
But enjoy, like you said, enjoy the cooking. Enjoy it.
Okay.
That's the fun. That's you know, one aspect of the joy of working, you know, is the work.
Right.
Right? Okay. And read it. You're reading it out loud as much as you can, right?
No.
Oh, gosh, it's a one-woman show. I don't know.
I mean, yeah, but I was waiting
For what?
Obviously the wrong thing.
Well,
okay.
Yeah, waiting for Santa Claus. Maybe it's gonna be December. If you're lucky.
Okay, I'm gonna read it.
I want my Santa now. Read it out loud to yourself now. Now. Today, you know, it's a one-woman show, right?
Yeah.
And you're gonna be performing it, right? So don't you like read it out loud and try it out and stuff? No.
I feel like I have to write it and then because I feel like there's the actor and then there's the writer and they're not married.
They get them married, or if they're not married, get them cohabitating, get them sharing, you know, the juices.
Okay.
Get it. Sure, you're allowed to do that. That's the fun part. I act out my stuff all the time. Man, I'm not even an actor.
Okay.
I do it really poorly, horribly in my apartment. You know, I don't know if I can. Yes.
The mentor, like in the heroine's journey, you
and
have a wand.
The
heroine.
Oh, yes, he's
in the heroine's journey. You have a want.
Yeah.
When the mentor shows up in the story, I'm having this challenge because I feel like my main character is figuring out what she wants, and the role of the mentor, I don't know if it, in my personal experience with a mentor, it's a subliminal message type thing where they guide you. It's not quite clear. But in the text, the mentor is clearly putting out crumbs to guide the character towards self-realization. But does that weaken the character, make the character's choices less active to have that happening? How do you keep the character still active and still have that mentor there?
I'm giving a smile and I just went, ha!
Oh.
And how handsome you look with your beard.
I'm Magalie. I forgot to introduce myself.
Hey, okay. Welcome. So here we are. Welcome back. So the mentor, does the appearance of the mentor in your story, or does the use or the employment of the mentor in your story weaken the story?
No.
Weaken the character.
Self-realize.
It gives the character room to self-realize.
Because
right.
At that point in the story, the character is shut down emotionally, psychologically, and she's just kind of like allowing herself to follow and discover by watching the mentor.
Okay.
And she starts to wake up
as
a result of observing the mentor. But I feel that the choice to wake up, I feel like the mentor is triggering it, and I don't know if that weakens the story if the mentor is triggering the choices to wake up.
So, okay, I'll tell you a very quick story about Suzan-Lori Park. So once upon a time, I was a writer, but I only wanted to write novels. And then I took a class with James Baldwin, and I was very animated, and he said, "Miss Parks, you should try by for the theater." And I said, "Okay." And I started that day. I don't know, maybe my choice was weak. Maybe it was because I didn't think of it myself. But hey, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes somebody's saying, "Wake up." All they're saying is, "Wake up." You're choosing to wake up. It's your choice, right? All the mentor can do is this. You're choosing to take the step. A lot of people you do this to, and they go, ah. And they walk the other way.
So that's the power of the character, knowing or choosing.
Right. You're choosing to take the step. That's the character's choice. Right? And that's huge. That's huge. What they say in India, I do a lot of yoga, what they say in India, the guru, it's not like the person with all the answers, it's the person with the light. The guru has a light, and all the guru does, or the teacher, is she or he holds the light so the student can see. And once the student sees, then the student makes a choice. And so it's not weak, you're not any weaker because you couldn't hold the light and take the step.
Right,
you're not weaker. Okay. Got it. Does that help? Just make sure that the main character is active and not passive. Make sure she or he is doing something.
Taking steps. What's that closer?
Sometimes that's all we can do.
Right.
Sometimes all you can do is show up. Sit there and say, "I don't got nothing today." You know, the muse likes that. She likes you to just go, "I'm here." You know?
Thank you.
You're welcome. One last question. Yes.
So, listening to some of the process, the approach, it reminds me of acting, absolutely. And I'm wondering if there's value in approaching something not so much from like the character, but maybe a little more abstract to find a character. Like by asking yourself themes, like I like betrayal, or I like sex, or I like this going on right now, and then in saying them, if that assembles in you something, perhaps.
Sure, that could work.
Yeah.
I just moved from, I would suggest, if that gets you moving and excited, great. Just, I would say, as soon as you can, attach. Decide on somebody. Just imagine, before you're born, your spirit was like fly around. You know, attached to my body so I can be born, you know what I'm saying? Because without that, I feel, in my opinion, we get writing that's a lot about ideas. Just ideas and themes, and you want it. Someone says, "I want to write a play about homelessness. Man, homelessness is wrong." And all you get for 2 hours is homelessness is wrong. And I know we got that in the first 3 minutes.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But if you have a character who is struggling with difficulties finding a home and all that kind of stuff, then we're invested.
Yeah.
Right? You see what I'm saying? So
sure, just attach it to someone that you need.
In land, invest in somebody, like the god, the Greek god, they used to come down and like, huh.
Yeah, you have to plant it. It's like when you plant a plant. You gotta water it.
Right, you can't just be carrying it around like this.
Yeah.
Plant it. Yeah, so sure, if the ideas, if the themes get you excited, that's great. But move in. Don't be afraid to like, oh, I don't know which body to pick. You know what I mean? Dive in, commit to somebody. Sales kind of went down this week. I know it's not your fault, huh? He's like an Apple genius person, but it's not your fault. It is all your fault. All right, cool. Just checking. Anybody else?
Someone can ask a question. You're allowed. You can ask. Just because you work on the show, don't mean you can't talk.
How do you avoid not wanting to give away the end, like that you know the end in mind,
right?
You're leading up to it,
right?
But you're scared that by you leading up to it, you're already giving it away,
right?
And sort of like prematurely saying the conclusion before you want to say,
right?
How,
right? So your question, Selma says, how do you avoid giving the end away?
Yeah.
Right.
Make
the writing interesting. Another way of saying that is, how do you stay ahead of the audience? Right, so we turn into something positive already. Right, how do you not give the end away? Instead, how do you stay ahead of the audience? Right, how do you stay ahead of the audience? I would say a couple things, and it might take, like, you might write a couple drafts and then in a reading notice some things you have to work on. But you basically want to invest in the characters, suck the juice out of the characters. Read a lot of Greek tragedy. Like, read Oedipus, you know what I'm saying, or Agamemnon, right? Because everybody going to the theater back in the olden days, they knew what the end was, right? You know what the end is? Oh, Agamemnon's gonna like get killed by his wife and blah 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 blah, right? But you're watching how it happens, so we don't get ahead of the play, right? The play stays ahead of us because you're so excited about the characters that you just are watching and you totally forget the end. And that's a joke about in the talk I heard about. You know what's gonna happen at the end? But you forget, by the end of the play, you've forgotten what's going to happen at the end. And you're like, oh shit! Right, I remember. You know what I'm saying? So you invest in the characters. Get us so interested in those people. Great, the people versus OJ. How many people saw it? I know you watched it. I know. Right? It's like, shit! Thank you guys for coming. You guys are great.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, it's always here. We're always